In the 1950s and 60s, the United States Air Force, DARPA, and NASA collaborated in taking a look at the concept of nuclear pulse propulsion. In other words, using nuclear detonations to propel a spacecraft, which Carl Sagan pointed out might be a good way to put the world's nuclear stockpiles to good use. The result was known as Project Orion, and while it went through a number of designs, the basic concept goes that you essentially detonate atomic explosions behind a sufficiently robust spacecraft to propel it through space at great speeds, unattainable by virtually any other means at our disposal, which is still true even with today's technology. Later advocates and researchers involved with this project included Wernher von Braun and Freeman Dyson, who spent a year working on the concept, but the idea originated with physicist Stanislaw Ulam in 1946, with further work done at Los Alamos a year later. By 1958, DARPA was providing $1 million per year for research into the concept, under the auspices of the General Dynamics Corporation, though they pulled out a year later, leaving it a joint endeavor between the Air Force, who was hoping for a military use, and NASA, who were hoping for manned spaceflight use. The concept envisioned a blast shield to protect the ship, and a shock absorber to mitigate the effects of the detonations and acceleration on the occupants, resulting in a continuous pulsed propulsion. A test in 1959 using conventional chemical explosions pushed a model a full 100 meters in altitude with 6 explosions, a successful proof of concept. This led NASA to propose a mission to Mars that only had a 125-day round trip, something usually envisioned with our currently used technology on the order of 9 months or more, though speed is everything there. And if we did it at the speeds the New Horizons spacecraft is traveling at, you could do it in far shorter of a time. Project Orion was canceled in 1964. There were several reasons for it. The first was a partial nuclear test ban treaty. Along with NASA's desire for near-term space exploration to not be nuclear in nature. But here's the thing. This technology is so powerful, at least potentially, that had we continued research into it and realized it, it's conceivable that there would not only be humans living on the surface of Mars today, but humans living in the Alpha Centauri star system, over 4 light years away. Whether it would have worked out that way, implementing it or not, is an open question. And it pays to remember, in those days, no one knew if that star system had any planets. And the idea of a spacecraft propelled by nuclear detonations is heady, to say the least. But the fact remains, we have an unrealized technology that can viably get us to another star system relatively quickly, whether manned or robotic. It was originally envisioned as a cheap way to do it, but it's not likely to have worked out that way. Today it would be expensive, I mean really expensive, depending on how far you take it. So here are the specifics of Project Orion at its greatest envisioned extent. In 1968, Freeman Dyson proposed a variant operating on fusion detonations, hydrogen bombs, that would have reached a velocity of 10,000 kilometers a second. Or, put into car engine terms, each detonation would be the equivalent of between 5 and 10 billion horsepower. Scaling this up from a solar system concept to an interstellar craft, variations of the idea could allow us to viably reach a sustained speed of 10% the speed of light. This means we're just 44 years from the next star system over, with current technology, and modern innovations might reduce that further in a redesign of the concept, or development of other more speculative ones. But it's still a huge risk. We know that there are planets in the system, but we don't know how many or what they are like. Something the James Webb Space Telescope promises to help understand through a series of recent observations. But we do know what the member stars are like, and by sheer luck, the universe happened to deposit about as ideal of a group of useful stars for colonization as you can get, and it did it right next door. The system includes 3 stars, all slightly older than the solar system. Unlike a lot of astronomical objects that have phone numbers or word salad for designations, these stars have names. They are Rigel Centaurus, Proxima Centauri, and Tolemon. Rigel Centaurus is a Sun analog, a type G star that's slightly more massive than the Sun, with about 1.5 times its luminosity. We know G-type stars can host life, because that's what we orbit. Tolemon, however, is a type K orange dwarf, thought to be a type of star that could favor habitability even more than a type G. Proxima Centauri is a Type M red dwarf, an active flare star, with X-ray emissions that might preclude any life being there, even though it does have an Earth-sized planet in its habitable zone. We don't entirely know the situation with Proxima b. If it formed in orbit of Proxima Centauri, its chances of being habitable may be very low. It's very close in to an active red dwarf, and it's likely to be bombarded with radiation that swells as the star flares. This may have long ago stripped it of an atmosphere, leaving a barren, rocky wasteland that's likely to be tidally locked to its parent star. There are some ideas that Proxima b may be a relatively recently captured planet, potentially having formed around one of the other stars outside their habitable zones, meaning that it could be an ocean world that was formerly an ice world that was captured and subsequently melted, and may be in the process of losing its atmosphere and water, though it would be exceedingly difficult to prove this without going there and taking a look around. There's at least one, but possibly two, other planets in orbit of Proxima Centauri. One is Proxima d, which is a sub-Earth, only about 25% the mass of our planet. This world is less likely to be of interest, as it receives a lot of radiation, and is likely to be hot, though its poles may host zones of habitability that we might look at for colonization. There is a disputed third planet, Proxima c, that might either be a super-Earth or mini-Neptune, but its existence has not been verified, and may just have been an artifact of the measurements. Together, these planets make up the closest exoplanets we know of to Earth. Should we ever reconsider Project Orion, Proxima Centauri is the natural and an ideal candidate star system for robotic exploration that could be accomplished within a human lifetime, if not humans going directly, but within that is an odd idea. We may never have to go anywhere outside of the solar system directly. Right now, our robotic spacecraft are proxies for us. If you can't send a human to Mars, you send a nuclear-powered robot to be your eyes and ears. That's our Mars rovers of today. But as technology advances to make virtual reality technology increasingly better, then that opens up the possibility of virtual exploration of planets like Proxima b based on the data returned by the probes, and perhaps even landers brought there by an Orion spacecraft. This would probably be the most expensive, and indeed extensive, mission in human history, but it remains one that we could do right now, in principle. In practice, the better bet is on smaller micro-spacecraft driven at high speed using lasers based in the solar system, such as Breakthrough Starshot, or NASA's plan to send such a probe in 2069, which will give us a look at another star system, but probably not a very in-depth one as you'd get with orbital craft and landers. The main stars of the system, Tolomana and Rigel Cantaris, may also have planets, though there is only one unconfirmed candidate for a Neptune-sized world in Rigel Cantaris's habitable zone, though this is disputed mainly due to it possibly having been an artifact of measurement or even dust. On the other hand, there's every reason to expect Earth-like planets around these stars, for the simple reason that if you've got enough material to form a triple star system, and you don't see any Jupiters or brown dwarfs, that leaves better chances for the materials from a protoplanetary disk to have accreted into smaller rocky planets. In particular, an Earth analog in the habitable zone of Rigel Cantaris would present ostensibly as Earth-like of a set of conditions as you can get. It doesn't guarantee another Earth, but it does open up the possibility for something that might be terraformable into another Earth, a process that can be started robotically. And after many thousands of years of remote terraforming, you'd have a world ready for human inhabitants to move right in. That's if there's even a planet there. But planets aren't necessary for colonies. The construction or transportation of an O'Neill cylinder to Alpha Centauri is also doable. Essentially, what's possible to do here in the solar system is likewise possible in Alpha Centauri. And again, there is the virtual exploration aspect. Interestingly, there is one area we know that one thing we have in common here on Earth is very close to the same thing at Alpha Centauri that we would share with anyone that might be there: the night sky. Albeit with some stars shifted in position slightly, most of the constellations and stars we see and are familiar with here on Earth would be very similar in appearance if viewed from Proxima Centauri, just 4.2 light years away. There would be one major difference, however. There would be a bright star added to the constellation of Cassiopeia, which would be our Sun, we'd actually be more visible to anyone at, say, Ptolemon, than the dim Proxima Centauri member of the same system would be. It would just be a star among the rest, whereas the Sun would be among the brightest in the sky, just as Alpha Centauri collectively is among our brightest. And it's going to get brighter. Another odd aspect is that currently the Alpha Centauri system is moving towards us. This is going to have an interesting effect over time. The star system, from our perspective, will gradually grow brighter and appear to move across the sky, coming visually close to Beta Centauri from our viewpoint, eventually moving into the vicinity of the Southern Cross and onwards towards the constellation Hydra. There, in about 25,000 years, it will make its closest approach to us, a mere 2.9 light years, before then gradually moving away and dimming. But we'll remain among the brightest stars in the night sky for a very long time, at least for the Southern Hemisphere. The Proxima Centauri system will never be the brightest star in the sky, however. Sirius holds that distinction and is also moving towards us and brightening to a crescendo in about 60,000 years. Curiously, right about the same time as it moves into the position as the Southern Pole star. Though Sirius is not on the table for the foreseeable future for human colonization, it's twice as distant. Alpha Centauri, however, may well have the distinction in the far future of being humanity's second star system. While Project Orion represents a doable way to travel interstellar space today, advances in fusion technology and even the potential development of antimatter reactions will expand the capability, to the point that if we ever do leave the solar system, it's almost certainly Alpha Centauri that we'll be destined for. As the future progresses, however, the two human star systems will drift apart, likely not only in distance, but no doubt in culture and technology as well. In the even further future, the two branches may no longer remember the other even exists. A strange future to envision, indeed. Thanks for listening. I'm futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently not going to Alpha Centauri. One sun is enough to deal with. Three? Well, how would anybody get any sleep? And be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular, in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.